Good morning, everybody. Welcome to church this morning. Lovely to see everyone here. And also welcome if you're online as well. God bless you all. So today we're going to be looking at taking nothing on the journey. And I think, you know, sometimes I went to Durham Cathedral this last week on my day off. And as I went round, it just struck me, the idea of pilgrimage and the fact that people have travelled there to pray and to seek God's face. And for each one of us, it's like that. We're on a journey. Our final destination is with our Heavenly Father in heaven. But at the moment, we're passing through. And I don't know about you, but when I go on a journey, I tend to take a lot of clobber with me. And Jesus is saying, take nothing with you. And Aidan will be explaining why, hopefully, later on when he gives us his talk. We'll start just by our opening prayer. And the words will come up on the screen. And when it comes to the response is in red if you want to say the response. Take nothing for the journey. Lord, you have said, neither bags nor food nor more clothing, but look to you instead. For you who clothe the flowers know exactly what we need. Come follow me, you say to us. Give us ears to heed. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So thinking about what we might have to give up, we're going to have a little session here where we're going to try and guess what's in my bag. And I'd like you to think about, when you're going on a journey, the type of thing that you might think is really important, particularly if it's a long journey, the kind of things. And David's going to go round with a little long microphone, which you can just pop your ideas into. And if any of your ideas are similar to what's in my bag, you'll see them emerging from my bag. So off you go, David. You might want to put your hand up if you would like to go first. Brilliant. Thanks.
A snack,
yeah. Absolutely. I've got a Snickers there. Has anyone noticed how much these have shrunk? I think in order to, like, my dad used to tell me when he was at university, he had a Mars bar and he used to cut it into segments and he'd have one segment each day of the week. Well, you couldn't do that now. Okay, very good. Next one.
Medication,
yeah. Absolutely. A few aspirin there. But I know sometimes if you're like me, you might go with a whole host of different bits of medication, Antisan, you know, anything for every eventuality, plasters, etc. Yep. Any more?
A drink of some sort.
Yeah, very important, especially in this warm weather. Got to keep hydrated. And actually, if you're going on hill walking like the bloke there, by the way, he's not carrying my rucksack. That's just a random geezer off the internet. But I couldn't very well take a selfie of me walking from behind very easily. So, but he's got the same colour as my rucksack. So, yeah, any more?
Waterproofs.
What's that, sorry?
Waterproofs.
Waterproofs? Oh, what's
your anorak,
that clothing? Man. Oh, yeah, anoraks, waterproofs. Yeah, absolutely. I did have a brolly, but unfortunately that's in the car now because I used it yesterday. So, but yeah, waterproofs. Any more?
Tissues,
yeah. There we go. I've actually got some moisturiser tissue cans and things there.
I'm being optimistic here. Sun cream.
Sun cream. Yes, that's very optimistic. We are in the northeast, but we have got a lot of sun at the moment. But yes, sun cream. Yeah. And is that the last one? No.
A map.
Yeah. If you like me, maps are very important. When I got my job as a visiting officer, my mum got me a sat nav because she knows my sense of direction's hopeless. And actually, having this map probably won't be that useful to me because I'm not very good at map reading, but hey, it looks pretty. Oh, another one.
A compass,
yeah. A compass to go with the map would be useful, especially if you knew how to use it. Maybe one day someone can teach me. I have got the compass, I just don't know how to use it.
Your phone.
Yeah, got to keep in touch with people. We'll have to pretend that it's a solar panelled phone, because obviously when you're out and about, you might not be able to connect into electricity. So here's a few other things I thought of. How about a musical instrument? being the good God, the Christian folk we have, Bible. Or if you're like me and you like a bit of comfort, something to sit on or a little pillow. And last but not least, the kitchen sink. So, joking aside, when we think about journeys, there must be something very important about why Jesus said, take nothing for the journey. And I'd just like you to have that in your head as we go through today's service and when Aidan comes and speaks to us later on. But sometimes, you know, God causes us, he wants things to go by the by because they're not important. There's something else that's more important that he wants us to focus on. We're going to have our first two songs, and after that, Dillis is going to come and do our two readings, and then Aidan will speak to us.
blessing and honor, glory and power be to the Ancient of Days. From every nation, all of creation, bow before the Ancient of Days. Exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall not pass away, O Ancient of Days. Blessing and honor, glory and power be to the Ancient of Days. From every nation, all of creation, bow before the Ancient of Days.
Our epistle reading is taken from 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 1 to 10. And it's Paul's vision and his thorn. I must go on boasting, although there is nothing to be gained. I will go on to visions and revelations from the Lord. I know a man in Christ who was 14 years ago was caught up to the third heaven. Whether it was in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that this man, whether in the body or apart from the body, I do not know, but God knows. He was caught up to paradise and heard inexpressible things, things that no one is permitted to tell. I will boast about a man like that. But I will not boast about myself, except about my weaknesses. Even if I should choose to boast, I would not be a fool, because I would be speaking the truth. But I refrain, so no one will think more of me than is warranted by what I do or say, or because of these surpassingly great revelations. Therefore, in order to keep me from becoming conceited, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me, but he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness." Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong. Can you please stand for the gospel? Our gospel reading this morning is from Mark, chapter 6, verses 1 to 13, a prophet without honour. Jesus left there and went to his hometown, accompanied by his disciples. When the Sabbath came, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were amazed. "Where did this man get these things?" they asked. "What's this wisdom that he's been given? What are these remarkable miracles he is performing? Isn't this the carpenter? Isn't this son, Mary's son, and the brother of James, Joseph, Judas and Simon? Aren't his sisters here with us?" And they took offence at him. Jesus said to them, "A prophet is not without honour except in his own town, among his relatives, and in his own home. He could not do any miracles there, except lay his hands on a few sick people and heal them. He was amazed at their lack of faith." Jesus sends out the 12. Then Jesus went around teaching from village to village, calling the 12 to him. He began to send them out two by two, and gave them authority over impure spirits. These were his instructions. Take nothing for the journey except a staff. No bread, no bag, no money in your belts. Wear sandals, but not an extra shirt. Wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave that town. And if any place will not welcome you or listen to you, leave that place and shake the dust off your feet as a testimony against them. They went out and preached that people should repent. They drove out many demons and anointed many sick people with oil and healed them. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks very much, Dillis. And we'll just say a quick prayer for Aidan before he comes. Father, thank you for your son, Aidan. And we ask that as he speaks to us, that we would hear you speaking directly to us, the things that we need to hear this week. Anoint our ears to be able to hear and our hearts to receive. In Jesus' name, amen.
Where did the other microphone go? If you'd left the other bit on, I would have been like Freddie Mercury. Do you remember that? With the stick? Before my time, really. Right. Take my mask off. Thanks, David. So, hopefully this works. Excellent. The two readings we had today are full of really good stuff. So I'm not going to talk about the epistle, but that doesn't mean that it's not worth reading. And as my lecturers used to say, I'll leave that one as a problem for you. So do go home and dive into that. Because it's full of really excellent stuff. But instead, I'm going to look at the Mark reading. And I'll just read the last part of that again. Then Jesus went round teaching from village to village, calling the 12 to him. He sent them out two by two and gave them authority over evil spirits. And I do like how in the gospel sometimes things are sort of said with not much fanfare, but that's actually quite a big deal. Gave them authority over evil spirits, just like that. These were his instructions. Take nothing for the journey except a staff. No bread, no bag, no money in your belt. Wear sandals, but not an extra tunic. Whenever you enter a house, stay there until you leave that town, and if any place will not welcome you or listen to you, shake the dust off your feet when you leave as a testimony against them. They went out and preached that people should repent. They drove out many demons and anointed many sick people with oil and healed them. As Tommy Cooper would say, just like that. Someone said it there with me. That was good. Well done. I'm not going to do any magic. I'm really sorry. Yeah. My favourite Tommy Cooper bit, this is a segue, my favourite Tommy Cooper bit is where he's got an egg and he very clearly puts it under his armpit and goes, look, no egg. And everyone goes, yeah, yeah. And he goes, ah, and it disappeared from there as well. It's fantastic. It's really clever. So let's talk about three things here. I'm going to talk about stuff. I'm going to talk about trust. I'm going to talk about staffs and sandals. Let's talk about stuff. In modern fashion, which tends to come and go, at the moment, it's quite fashionable to not have stuff. If you go on YouTube and look for decluttering, there are thousands of people making a living by recording themselves getting rid of their stuff and saying how it makes them feel fantastic and it makes them feel lighter and how they're more connected with the people around them. I was watching one where the lady says, it might look to you like my house is empty, but actually it's full of memories and full of laughter. I thought, well, that's a bit corny. But she's, you know, probably right. And so she'd embraced minimalism. And if you remember, minimalism is also something that's come and gone, and it was a reaction to another fad, and these come and go. And you can imagine that we'll probably have another bout of minimalism in about, you know, 40 years, 50 years time, and in the interim period, it'll be very fashionable to have all the latest technical stuff. So it seems to be the case that humans and society occasionally remember that it's not actually a good idea to have lots of things and stuff. And I wonder if that's just a kind of a reflection, a cyclical reflection of the fact that we as Christians know that that's not what is important. And the rest of society kind of forgets and then comes back and then forgets again and then goes, actually, this makes no sense, and comes back and then forgets again. And at the moment, they're called life hacks. I'm sure you've seen the videos of the life hacks, you know, how to tidy under your bed or whatever, and, you know, normally using nothing but a pallet, a large workshop, 13 tons of glue and one elastic band. And you often get, I think, modern teachers now as well who come across these, I've just discovered this life hack for making your life simpler. And I kind of think, as a Christian, I sort of already knew it. You know, it's not really a life hack for me, you know. Focus on Jesus and everything else is secondary. Remove things from your life that get in the way of God or replace him. That's how a Christian would phrase it. So who thinks they have too many things? So you see, no one put their hand up initially, and then when I looked at them with the teacher's stare. I've never been a teacher, actually. I always think that would be quite interesting to see how effective the stare was, because I've been on the receiving end of it once or twice. And let's talk about ability as well. So it's fairly well documented that humans are really dreadful judges of their own ability. So if you all just close your eyes, and online you don't need to close your eyes, but in the room, close your eyes. Trust me, I'm not going to come around and hit you or anything. I'm going to stay at the front. Close your eyes. Put your hand up if you think you're above average at most things. Okay, so you can open your eyes. I just didn't want there to be any crowd effect. So no one put their hand up, but averages mean that some people will be and some people won't be. So close your eyes again. Who thinks they're below average at talking to other people? Okay, thanks. Let's have one more. Who thinks you're above average at cooking? Okay. So really, any time you ask that question in a room, about half the hands should go up, but they don't, because we're really bad at working out what we're good at. We don't understand our own ability. We're often quite quick to tell other people about their ability, but we're not very good at our own. Imposter syndrome, you'll all have heard of that probably, people thinking that they don't sort of deserve to be in the job that they're in. And Woolley has said several times and I know he'll be listening intently online. Uli has said several times, God first calls us, and then he... They were listening! They said it! Well done! God first calls, then he equips. So go forth with nothing, and let's sort out the detail on the way. What are you being called to? And are you listening? At the moment, we are building a new worship group for the new 10:30 service, which will start when restrictions end. And it's a coming together of the two music groups that you've been listening to and watching over the last few months in the videos, which are looking and sounding fantastic, by the way. Thank you to the team who do those. And we're working really, really hard, everyone in those two groups, to make sure that we keep the heart of both of them and that we create something that is new and is better able to worship God and lead others in worshiping God. And I wonder if there are some of you who are being called to join that, and you either haven't heard that call or you've heard it and maybe said, well, my ability doesn't really match that. I'm below average at the ukulele. Or I'm not as good as I could be at the kazoo. Other instruments are available. Don't worry about the equipping. Don't worry. Just come forward. Just start the journey. God will equip. We will encourage. And we'll worship together. So if that's something you feel like you're being called to, then I'd encourage you to speak to Uli about that. Let's talk about trust. Hopefully. There we go. No. Come on. There we go. Let's talk about trust. I was trying to find a picture that looks like trust. And this was one of the defaults on Google Slides, right? But I thought, it looks like there's no barrier on the left. That looks like it's a platform for jumping off. I don't think it is. But it looks like you sort of go up the stairs and just... And I thought, well, that's all right if someone's going to catch you. So in a slightly convoluted way, I think that talks about trust. And I've been waiting to say this next bit since I really became a professional scientist almost a decade ago. Make you feel all old. Makes me feel old. This is true. I was working in the lab late one night. So for those of you who don't know, I work in the COVID test lab. Because I'm a chemist, and it's a big lab. We do 40,000 samples a day, and you see all sorts of things. But here's my little do your bit for COVID. What we see are called sometimes called voids, which means we can't process the sample. And there's lots of different ways you can have voids. So they come in a little vial. If you've done a test, you know what I mean, the little plastic vials, and you stick the thing up, you know, stick it in your mouth, and then you stick it in the tube and put the lid on, and that disappears off somewhere. And then at the other end of that, I might get your little vial. And sometimes, bless them, sometimes people write their names on them, which you're not meant to do. And if we get that, we have to like destroy it because it's confidential, you know, so we're not meant to have those. So don't write your name on them. That's my first point. But, you know, sometimes you just get a little glimpse of someone passing through, you know, Margaret, you know, and the vial goes and you don't see it again. But anyway, so we get these vials. We get 40,000 of these a day and we test them. But sometimes someone's left the swab in. Someone's not put the swab in. Or there's no liquid in the vial because they've looked at it and gone, oh, that's just to keep it clean, throwing the liquid away and then put the swab on and put the lid on. So put your swab in your vial. Don't pour the liquid away. Make sure the cap's on nice and tight. And in that lab, we have lots of robots. And the robot comes and picks the thing up and takes it over here, and it's very clever. Shakes it a bit and adds some liquid and takes some liquid out and does a test, and there's some fluorescence and lights come on, and very, very clever. And the humans all just sort of sit around waiting for the robot. It's quite funny, really. And so quite sort of androids dreaming of electric sheep, I think. And there's PCs, there's robots, there's humans. And late one night, whilst in the lab, quite long periods of sort of time where you're, you know, maybe waiting for a robot or something, or there's not samples coming in. So some days we'll have far fewer samples. And so one night a while ago, when it was a quiet night, I was thinking
about what's the difference fundamentally between a robot and a human. Any ideas? Have we got the long stick, David? Just keep the cameraman on his toes. He thought he could sit down for a rest there. Just getting my inner Freddie Mercury out. Right, so, what are the differences between robots and humans? I've thought about this a lot.
A human has a soul.
Okay, that's easy to say. What does that mean? Anyone else?
Humans can display emotion.
I could make a computer display an emotion, couldn't I? Give it a face, give it a happy face, give it a sad face, say to it. The human would have to give it to it first. Okay, so there has to be some prior instruction, like DNA. So a human has sort of prior instruction, maybe, perhaps. See, I went through all of this on a 6-hour shift in my head, went round and round in circles. Any more? Be brave, go on. Yes, Dillis.
Robots don't need to eat or drink.
Robots don't need to eat or drink. But do robots need resources? Do they need electricity? Yeah, see, you see where I'm going now? This isn't easy as you thought. Any more? Well, that was a half hand, go on.
Robots don't have a bad day.
I guarantee you some of the ones I work with do. Any others?
Eventually a robot will get superseded and die, or a human can live forever if you're a Christian.
Ooh. Until the last bit there. Yeah, a human can live forever if they're a Christian, but eventually a robot will get superseded or die. Interesting. Okay. The Live Aid concert has finished. If you haven't already seen that, by the way, go and look for that performance of Freddie Mercury doing Live Aid. Absolutely incredible. And listen to how he talks about the experience of doing that. For another time, perhaps. So, it's not decision-making. Computers can do that. It's not learning. Computers can do that if you program them to learn, like humans are programmed to learn. It's not memory. Computers have got memory. It's not actually reproduction. You could make a robot that made another little robot that then went and gathered resources to make another robot that was the same size as the first robot. It's not DNA, really. Computers are coded. I did eventually realize that in an animal or a human, the DNA is in every cell, whereas in a robot, it's centrally held. That's kind of a fundamental difference. But then I realized, actually, you could make a robot that had the DNA in every cell. It's quite hard, but it's doable. There's no sort of technical barrier to that. So this is more homework for you. You can sit and ponder this one now for the next week. Answers on a postcard, please, or an email. But humans have one thing that's definitely different that we're kind of touching on there. Humans can have faith. Because really, faith bridges the gap between the evidence and the belief. So you can program a robot to have faith, as it were. You can program it to believe in something. You know, you can program it to know there's something over there, and then you can take the thing away, and the computer will still think it's there, if you've told it. But only if you've told it. There can't be a gap. The computer can't bridge the gap itself. So trusting God and having faith is really making that decision based not just on the evidence or the rationale, but on a jump, on a personal connection, which seems paradoxical. But without that ability to trust or not to trust, to have faith or not to trust, then I think that it would be much more difficult to distinguish us from the robots, just following the instructions given to us, regardless of what they were, without the ability to make a change from them. And that's what this reading is also about. It's about trust, because Jesus says to them, go forth, I've got you back. And that's what you get. And you make a decision. Do you have faith? Do you go with it? Or do you need more? And if we need more, will we always need more? At some point, you have to just jump. So finally, Jenny said earlier, take nothing on the journey. That's actually not quite what it said, is it? It doesn't say take nothing. It says, accept a staff and wear sandals, but not an extra shirt.
So why is that?
Well, let's be prepared, I suppose. You know, let's be good Boy Scouts or Girl Scouts. God will protect us, but we can also protect ourselves through what he's given us. We can take care of certain things. We aren't, you know, wrapped in cotton wool in this world. We can make our choices. And it's more that we have an eternal supply of all possible things that we might need by the grace of God. So why take a staff? Why a staff and not, I don't know, a Ferrari? Or anything else that you happen to like. You know, why not take that coat that you like? Why not take, I don't know, your Xbox or whatever it is? And I think the difference is intent. Why are you taking the staff? Why are you taking the Ferrari? Why are you taking the handbag, the Victoria sponge, whatever it is? The staff wards off animals, allows you to travel easier. You can lend it to people in need. Who's read or heard or seen The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy? Yeah, a few of you. The rest of you are just going to have to tune out while I talk about this bit, sorry. In The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, they talk about towels. And the guy says, the most important thing an intergalactic hitchhiker can have is a towel. You can use it to sunbathe. You can use it to fight off evil, ravenous beasts on far-flung worlds. You can use it to mop up the blood when your fellow hitchhiker gets chopped in half by an airlock. You know, lots of uses for a towel when you're an intergalactic hitchhiker. And the point is the same. A towel is there to allow you to hitchhike. The staff and the sandals are there to help you take the word of God to others. So don't take this literally, I don't think. You know, the world has changed, so maybe now the instruction would be take a simple, reliable car. Take enough money so that you can travel, perhaps. Or it might be leave your mobile phone behind, you don't need it, possibly. Or do you really need that mobile phone? Could be all sorts of things, but the point is not the thing. The point is the intent. The point is why are you taking it? Are you taking it so that you can better tell others about God? Or are you taking it for yourself? And that's the difference. So as you're being sent out on this journey to tell others, check why are you taking what you're taking. And that's the key, I think, here. Clear the way to God. Take only what is needed. Trust God and tell others. It's a simple message. Let's pray. Lord, we ask that you help us to recognize why we have stuff. We ask you to help us to know when you are asking us to do something and to trust that you will equip us. Be the center of our lives, God. And help us to remove those things which prevent us from talking to others about you. Amen.
Thank you, Aidan. There's a lot to chew over there and a lot to be thinking about. We're going to have our next song and then Viv's going to come and do our prayers for us after that.
Very truly I tell you, the one who believes has eternal life.
I am the bread of life.
Your ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, yet they died.
But here is the bread that comes down from heaven, which anyone may eat and not die.
Fountain of life poured out for me.
one who believes has eternal life.
I am the bread of life.
Let us come before our Lord uncluttered, without rucksacks full of stuff. Let us come quietly. I won't recall responses from people today. I want us to consider something that Jesus' own mother tongue taught us in the Aramaic, the language of Jesus. The meaning of prayer is to set a trap for God. It is to wait patiently, still and alert, to catch the thoughts of God, that is to trap the inner guidance and impulses. So let us open our hearts as a trap for God, so that we will catch all he has for us and all he is for us. Father of all, innocent of each accusation, unless perhaps the folly of loving us too much, you are not to blame. Bring us your counsel. May we find new patterns as we step into our unique destiny, as breath taking in their beauty, as anything we might glimpse in the nighttime depths of the heavens, and knowing you will supply all we have need of day by day. May we live in your peace, be carriers of forgiveness, spilling its healing freely everywhere. Keep me free from materialism. Keep us free from materialism, so our possessions never possess us. Guard us from foolish choices and their consequences. Truly yours is all counsel, all power and majesty through endless ages. Hear our heart's song, O Lord, and keep us faithful. Sometimes when we pray, we utter words, but we do not think of them. God of all grace in foolishness and pride, we often dare to speak on your behalf, claiming to know your ways and making promises we struggle to keep. Help us in humility to learn to be still, trusting that you are indeed God. We confess that we have heard your voice in prayer, yet we have plugged our ears. We have seen your face in the pages but turned away. We have felt your touch through the hands of one another and we've still pulled away. Please forgive us. We trust in you, God, as we live in the paradox of being purposefully lost, deliberately uncertain, and resolutely confused. Our hope is in you alone, Lord, for the potential that you see in us and the possibilities that lie ahead, Christ be before us. For our plans and their fulfillment, and for your promises and their unfolding, Christ be before us. In the problems that beset us and the perils that ensnare us, Christ be within us. God, as we strive for success, for wealth, for stability, for status, turn our eyes down from the mountain that we may see to wash the feet of the world. For if we pray, we will believe. If we believe, we will love. And if we love, we will serve. In all that comes our way, open our hearts to you. Help us believe that all things will work out for our good because we love you. We will not be dragged down by life's challenges. We will pray and know that we have been heard. We ask you, Lord, during this time, to challenge us, to encourage us, and to change us, that we may continue to grow and be transformed in this process, and that we find hope to offer the world around us, in our conversations, in our sharing, in our eating, in our resting, in our learning and our laughing. May we notice you. May we find you. May we follow you. And may we offer you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thanks, Viv. We've just come to our notices time. Does anybody have any notices that they need to give out? Yep. Do you want to come up, Danny?
As there is no such thing as too much prayer, Tuesday 9:30 in the Side Chapel, we will start the first of what will hopefully be a weekly event of morning prayer, making use of common worship, so slightly more traditional than what is currently going on at the minute. So please come and join us. If you can't, pray about it and we'll see what God can do and what God can transform through it. Thank you.
Thanks, Danny, and I think Viv's got a notice as well.
Hi, it's just an appeal for the LLF project, the project Willie's spoken about, where we have been asked by our bishops to discuss relationships, sexuality, gender, and marriage. If you would be interested in joining that project with us over two dates, probably on Saturdays, sometime in August, I've asked the guys, the tech guys, to put my email address up on the screen there. Please contact me and I can let you know some more information. Also, in the meantime, at the back of the church, there's a selection of resources, books. It would be really interesting for people to read them. And what I would suggest, or maybe can I suggest, anybody who is interested in embarking on this project, would you start to write a journal? I want you to prayerfully and use your scripture and journal the thoughts and listen for God's voice as he speaks to us about this project. Thank you.
Thanks, Viv. That's just so important. I can't commend that enough to you. This is the most divisive issue that the church has faced in my lifetime. I really think it is hugely difficult, not just here, but in the diocese and nationally. So really, really important. Thanks. I want to commend Aidan's sermon to us to think about. I don't know about you, but it's really got me going. I thought about baggage because I think we've all probably got too much. One of the experiences that profoundly affected my life was I walked part of the Santiago de Compostela route, and Liz Allen's done it as well. I started the route with too big a rucksack, and you get too weary. So after a couple of days, you start ditching gear, and you really have to strip down, not literally, but yeah. One of the things that profoundly affected us was my friend and I were absolutely exhausted at the end of a really hard day. And a young guy came around the corner towards us, and it was a stony, rocky path, and he was wearing flip-flops. Now, to our great shame, in our tired state, we walked on, and that, what a shame that was, because I had a spare pair of trainers in my rucksack. But the next day, we saw the same guy, and he was marching along. Somebody had kicked him out in boots. We've all got too much we can share. And I commend to you the idea of maybe going for have a day out, a retreat, a quiet day somewhere. Shepherd's Dean, Alnmouth, there's loads of places. There's a monastery, a friary at Alnmouth. You go, you can spend a day, and it's just good. And it's good to switch off the mobile and, yeah, retreat. The other thing that I'm waffling on here, so I'm going to shut up and go away. One more thing for prayer. Please keep up the prayers for Kintsugi Hope. We feel the group's going well, and we're dealing with some significant issues. So please do keep the prayers going. Wednesday night, 7 o'clock. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, David. Yeah, it's very important, isn't it? You know, we're living in a very sort of stress-filled world, and you know, to actually be able to hear God's voice, we need to be able to draw aside sometimes. And yeah, I think that's really good to mention the monasteries and the retreat days. Okay, so we're coming to our final bit of the service where we're just going to say the blessing. We're going to say it to each other because we're all children of God, and God causes us all, he says, you know, for us to be a blessing to others and to bless others. So I invite you to say with me, it will come up on the screen, there'll be a blessing prayer which I invite you to pray. But just before that, I'm just going to read a little verse from Psalm 32, verse 2. Let's just hear the comfort that God says to us. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my loving eye on you. So if we say the blessing together with each other. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless us on our journey as we seek to follow you. Be the pillar of cloud by day and fire by night to guide us. Cause us to be a blessing to those you send us to. Bless them that they also may believe. Be our shield and our provider, and watch over us now and always. Amen. So go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen. And we're going to have our final song.
Rise up, women of the truth, stand and sing to broken hearts, who can know the healing power of our awesome King of love.
Shout to the north and the south, sing to the east and the west, Jesus is dead in your heart, Lord of heaven and earth.
Weeping through fire and weeping through rain, weeping to find out the power of his name. Keep falling deeper in love with you. You found the truth and the land.
Shout to the north and the south. Sing to the east and the west. Jesus is saving the heart, Lord of heaven and earth.
Rise up, church, with broken wings.
Fill this place with songs again.
Before God,
His grace.